بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We continue the explanation of Riyad al-Salihin, and we have reached hadith number 45. And in this hadith, which is reported by Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, he said أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: ليس الشديد بالسرعة، إنما الشديد الذي يملك نفسه عند الغضب. أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه reported that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the strong man is not the one who is good at wrestling. The strong man is not the one who is good at wrestling, but the strong man is the one who controls himself in a fit of rage or in a fit of anger. And in the next hadith, hadith 46, the hadith of Sulaiman bin Surad رضي الله عنه قال: كنت جالسا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ورجلان يستبان، وأحدهما قد احمر وجهه وانتفخت أوداجه، فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إني لأعلم كلمة لو قالها لذهب عنه ما يجد، لو قال أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ذهب منه ما يجد. فقالوا له: إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: تعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ومتفق عليه. In the hadith of Sulaiman bin Surad رضي الله عنه, may Allah be pleased with him, he reported that I was sitting with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when two men began to quarrel and curse each other, and the face of one of them turned red and the veins of his neck were swollen from rage. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I know of a word, if he were to utter it, his rage would vanish, and that is أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, which means I seek refuge with Allah from Satan the accursed. So they, the companions, said to him, the Prophet ﷺ tells you to utter, I seek refuge in Allah from Satan the accursed. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek refuge with Allah from Satan the accursed. These two narrations are about the matter of anger and rage. And the anger is a burning fire which Shaitan throws in the heart of the children of Adam, and so he becomes the person becomes raged, and his cheeks become swollen, and the veins of his neck also becomes swollen. His cheeks become red, and the veins of his neck become swollen. And the person will utter words that he may not comprehend, and act in ways that are irrational at all, but not in any way are rational, but irrational. And that's why a man came to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Awsini, admonish me." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تغضب, don't get angry. قال فردد مرارا, and so he repeated it many times saying, don't get angry. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the hadith of Abi Huraira here mentioned that the strong man is not the one who is good at wrestling, meaning the one who goes and overpowers people and defeats them in wrestling. This is referred to by people as a strong man, but the Prophet ﷺ said in reality this is not the strong one. The strong one is the one who controls himself in the time of anger or in a fit of rage. This is the true person who is a strong and powerful person, and who overcomes his desires of motivations of rage and controls them. This is the real power. an internal strong drive where the person overcomes Satan, because it is Satan who throws this burning fire in the heart of the person to rage him. So in this hadith there is the incitement to control oneself at the time of anger, and that the person should not go along with it, because he will regret that later. Many times a person becomes angry and then he divorces his wife, and it may be that this is the last divorce, the last one out of the three. So she then does not become lawful for him after that, until she marries another person. And if divorced from that other person, and in a legal way, not in a cheating way, then she may return with a new contract to her former husband. Anyway, this issue is that the issue is that the anger drives the person to divorce his wife. Also, this anger drives the person to destroy his wealth, either by setting it on fire or breaking it. Many times also the person gets angry and beats his son or daughter, and he may kill them in the process. And also a person may get angry on his wife, at his wife, and therefore and ends up beating her severely. Many of these things occur, and occur at the time of anger. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade for the judge to decree between two people when he is two disputing people when he is angry. And this hadith is in Al-Bukhari and in Muslim, because the anger prevents the judge from contemplating the issue between them, and also therefore prevents him from applying the Sharia law upon them, and so he may end up destroying them and end up judging between people in an unjust way. Also in the narration here of Sulaiman bin Surad, the hadith of Sulaiman bin Surad, may Allah be pleased with him, concerning the two people who quarreled and cursed each other. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, I know the word, if he were to utter that, his rage would vanish. And it is, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, I seek refuge with Allah from Satan the accursed. The Shaytan al-Rajim, because what befalls this person is from Shaytan. So therefore, the legal thing is that when the person becomes angry, is to refrain himself and be patient. Refrain himself and be patient, and seek refuge in Allah from the accursed Shaytan. This is what we really need to remember by saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, and also by taking other measures, like from the Sunnah is to make wudu, ablution, because the ablution extinguishes the rage. And if the person is standing, then he sits, and if he is sitting, then he lies down. And if he is worried about continuing, he may leave the place where he is in, so that he does not express his anger and then regrets that afterwards. And this is really what happens many times with us. We get angry and we regret, and it is very stressful even on the person, because when he sees what he has done moments ago after this rage of anger, he looks at himself with regret and wishes that he did not say what he had uttered. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist us to control ourselves at the time of anger and to remember the prophetic treatment of this matter. In the next hadith, hadith 47, from Mu'ad bin Anas رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من كظم غيظا, the one who suppresses anger, وهو قادر على أن ينفذه, and he has the power to give effect to it, meaning to express it, to give vent to it, will be called out by Allah. دعاه الله سبحانه وتعالى, the one free of all imperfection, the Most High, will invite him على رؤوس الخلائق يوم القيامة, to the forefront of the creatures on the day of resurrection, and he will be asked to choose any of the virgins, the حور of his liking. من الحور العين حتى يخيره من الحور العين ما يشاء. These are the حور, the woman of paradise, bright and large-eyed maidens. He will choose from them what he wishes. This hadith of Mu'adh bin Anas is reported by Abi Dawood and at-Tirmidhi. And also an Imam Ahmad and a Sheikh al-Albani rahimahullah considered it to be Hassan, good narration. Also in the hadith 48 عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رجلا قال للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أوصني, قال لا تغضب, فردد مرارا قال لا تغضب. رواه البخاري. أبو هريرة, may Allah be pleased with him, reported a man asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم for an advice, and he صلى الله عليه وسلم said, don't get angry, and the man repeated that several times, and he replied, don't get angry. This is reported by al-Bukhari. And in the next hadith عن أبي هريرة, the hadith of أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, ما يزال البلاء بالمؤمن والمؤمنة في نفسه وولده حتى يلقى الله تعالى وما عليه خطيئة. رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن صحيح. أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, a Muslim, male or female, continues to remain under trial in respect of this life, property and offspring, meaning he will be tried and tested with all these things until he faces Allah Ta'ala, the Exalted One, with no sin record, free of sins. And this hadith is reported by Tirmidhi, who said that it is hadithun hasanun sahih, good and authentic narration. These narrations altogether, as you can tell, they speak about the subject of patience and the refrainment and the merits of patience. As to the first hadith, the hadith of Mu'ad bin Anas, the one who suppresses anger and has the power to give effect to execute it, will be called out by Allah, the Exalted, to the forefront of the creatures on the day of resurrection, and he will be asked to choose any of the virgins of his liking. This refrain, the ghayz, the anger, the term ghayz here refers to the intense anger. In the hadith here, it refers to the intense anger. And the person who becomes angry is the one who thinks that he is capable to execute and vent it. But because the one who doesn't does not get angry, however, he gets grieved. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the attribute of anger applies, and it is from his attributes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets angry, but we cannot attribute the attribute of grief to Allah, because the grief is a defect, and the anger in its right place is perfection. Anger in its right and proper place is perfection. So if a person becomes angry at another person while he is able to execute his anger and harm him, but he leaves that for the sake of Allah's face and perseveres as to the harm inflicted upon him, then he will have a great reward, and he will be called on the day of resurrection, as in this hadith, he will be called to the forefront of the creatures on the day of resurrections, and he will be asked to choose any of the virgins, the huris of his liking. And as to the hadith of Abi Huraira, the man said, Ya Rasulullah, admonish me. Asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, advise me. And he said, La taghdab, don't get angry. And then he repeated it. And the third hadith is also evidence that the person, when he is patient and anticipates the reward with Allah, then Allah expiates his sins for him. And so if the person is afflicted or tested by a calamity in himself or in his offspring or in his wealth, and then he is patient on that, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to test him, and Allah tests him and with trials and tests, so that he wipes all of his sins through that. So if he is patient and perseveres and anticipates the reward, but if he is resentful, then he will receive the wrath of Allah upon him. So if he is patient, he will walk on the face of the earth, and there is no sin with him. The next hadith is hadith 50. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قدم عيينة بن حصن فنزل على ابن أخيه الحر بن قيس وكان من النفر الذين يدنيهم عمر رضي الله عنه وكان قراء أصحاب مجلس عمر رضي الله عنه ومشاورته كهولا كانوا أو شبانا فقال عيينة لابن أخي يا ابن أخي لك وجه عند هذا الأمير فاستأذن لي عليه فاستأذن فأذن له عمر فلما دخل قال هه يا ابن الخطاب فوالله ما تعطينا الجزل ولا تحكم فينا بالعدل فغضب عمر رضي الله عنه حتى هم أن يوقع به فقال له الحر يا أمير المؤمنين إن الله تعالى قال لنبيه خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين وأن هذا من الجاهلين والله ما جاوزها عمر حين تلاها وكان وقافا عند كتاب الله تعالى ورواه البخاري. In this hadith, this lengthy hadith of Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with them, he said that Uyayna bin Husn came to Al-Madina and stayed with his nephew Al-Hur bin Qais, who was among those whom Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, showed favor to. And the knowledgeable people, the Qurra, whether they were old or young, had the privilege of joining Umar's council, and he used to consult them. Uyayna said to Hur, my nephew, the leader of the believers shows favor to you. Will you obtain permission for me to sit with him? So Al-Hur asked, Umar asked, and he accorded permission. He was given permission. When Uyayna came into the presence of Umar, he addressed him like, O son of Khattab, like in a denunciation form. You neither bestow much on us nor deal with us justly. See what he accused him? You neither bestow much on us nor deal with us justly. Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, got angry and he was about to beat him up. When the Hur said, O leader of the believers, Allah said to his prophet, خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين. He said to him, he recited the verse, O leader of the show forgiveness, enjoin what is good, and turn away from the foolish. meaning don't punish them. This one is from the ignorance, that the one who uttered these things. When the Hur recited this, Umar became quite motionless in his seat, and he always adhered strictly to the book of Allah. Now, this is another narration indicating the merit of patience and restraining oneself and suppressing one's anger. So this hadith was mentioned from Ibn Abbas that Umar ibn al-Khattab, the leader of the believers and the third man in this ummah after its prophet and after Abu Bakr, the first khalifa, the first leader of the believers, Umar is the second. And he was famous for his justice, the application of justice amongst his people, amongst the people. And he was known to adhere strictly to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this person of Uyayna bin Husn, and he was from the notable of his people, came to Umar and said, "Hey, Ibn al-Khattab, this is O son of al-Khattab, this is O son of al-Khattab, and this is a word of denunciation and complaint." And he said, "Innaka la tu'tina al-jazl, you neither bestow much on us nor deal with us justly, wala tahkum fina bil adl." So you see this man now speaking and addressing Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Khalifa who is known for his justice. He's addressing him with these words of accusation. Yet as Umar radiallahu, as Ibn Abbas in this narration mentioned, that those adhering to Umar's majlis council were people who are qurra, those who used to have knowledge in the Quran. They are from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and whether they were elderly or young, he used to consult and draw nearer to Umar. And so this is what should be done by every leader or khalifa, that he should have good company, because if they were not good company, he will be destroyed, and he will destroy the ummah of Muslims. But if there are good people around him, then that will benefit the ummah. So what is obligatory therefore upon the leader is to choose from the people of knowledge and faith, those who are capable those who admonish in all that which is good. And the companions, may Allah be pleased with all of them, the qurra, those who used to learn the Quran, are from the people of knowledge, because they did not exceed 10 verses until they learned them, learned their meaning and what is to be done from these verses, meaning to act upon them. So when this man stood up and spoke to Umar in this way, in this very rude and aggressive way, "You don't give us, distribute on us, bestow much of us, nor deal justly with us," he became angry, and to the extent that he was about to beat him. But then he was advised by one of the companions who was present there. He said to him, and he recited the verse from Surah Al-A'raf, chapter 7, verse 199. خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين. Show forgiveness, enjoin what is good, and turn away from the foolish, meaning don't punish them. So Umar strictly adhered to the verse, because this was the case with Umar. He used to ascribe strictly to the texts, may Allah be pleased with him. And he did not beat this person, nor did he punish him. because of the verse that was revealed in front of him. And now just contemplate the etiquettes of the companions. May Allah be pleased with them concerning the Book of Allah, that they don't transgress its boundaries. If it is said to them, this is the saying of Allah, they will strictly adhere. They will strictly adhere. So the saying of Allah here, خذ العفو, show forgiveness. So take the forgiveness from the people, whatever is attainable from that, and don't seek your full right. Don't seek your full right, because you're not going to be able to attain that. So take what is available and make things easy. And وأمر بالعرف, وأمر بالعرف, meaning enjoin what is good, and what is good is what is revealed. The good is that is the all good is in the revelation, in the commands and in the prohibitions. And don't call to that which is munkar, that which is evil and bad, because the matters are of three types. Is a munkar, an evil, that should be warned, that there should be warning about, and then there is good with which should be enjoined. And this, the third is neither this nor that, so the person is to be quiet concerning it. In the case of advice and admonition, the person should not say except that which is good. In the process of advice and admonition, he should not say except that which is good, because of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir, falyaqul khayran aw liyasmut." The one who believes in Allah and in the last day, let him say that which is good, or let him keep silent. And then in the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ, and turn away from the foolish. So those who act in these foolish ways, then turn away from them. And your turning away is not because of your weakness, or it's not a humiliation, neither to you. So the position of Umar here, therefore, was clearly manifested. Umar is able to harm this person and punish him because of what he uttered, but he turned away from that, and he complied with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ignorance has two meanings. First is not being able or not knowing of the matter. This is one meaning, not knowing of the matter or of the affair. The second is foolishness. And this should be warded off in a good way, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in Surah Fussilat 41:34. قال الله تعالى ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. And this is in Surah Fussilat 41:34. 41:34. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the good deed, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ ادْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. The good deed and the evil deed cannot be equal. So ward off or repel the evil with one which is better. Meaning that Allah ordered the faithful believers to be patient at the time of anger and to excuse those who treat them badly. Then verily, فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Then verily, he between whom and you there was enmity will become as though he was a close friend. يعني subhanallah, a person between you and him enmity, and he does bad to you, treats you badly, then Allah commands you to ward and repel that with that which is good, because this will immediately bring you the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ, then verily he between whom and you there is enmity, or there was enmity, will become though as a close friend. And this is said by whom? This is said by Allah Azza wa Jal, the most mighty and most magnificent, the one who turns the hearts. There is no heart from the hearts of the children of Adam except that it is between two fingers, from the fingers of the most beneficent Allah, the most mighty and most majestic. He turns them as he wishes. So this is if the person, there is enmity between you and him, and you repel him in that which is good, then enmity will be changed into friendship and good relations, and as a close friendship. So therefore this ayah, which was cited to Umar in this circle around him, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ, this in forgive, show forgiveness, enjoin what is good, and turn away from the foolish, don't punish them. So when that was revealed, it was mentioned rather to Umar رضي الله تعالى عنه, he ceased and he did not harm this person and did not respond to his ignorance in any other way except to ascribe to the verse. So here we should learn when these things occur, sometimes many of us do get carried away, and they could not suppress their anger. And the advice to myself and to everyone who listens is to remember the Book of Allah and to hasten to tawbah and forgiveness, asking him to guide us on this path of istighfar and of seeking forgiveness and seeking refuge in Allah from the accursed devil who ignites this burning fire in the hearts of the children of Adam, so that lest we fall in misguidance. And because the one who ascribes and holds to the guidance of Allah Azza wa Jal, then Allah promises, as in Surah Taha 22:123, فَمَنِ اتَّبَعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى, فمن اتبع هدايا فلا يضل ولا يشقى. Then whoever follows my guidance shall neither go astray nor fall into distress and misery. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, forgive our shortcomings, and forgive our stages of rage and anger that went uncontrolled and went with regret afterwards, and to make ourselves submissive to the way that pleases him. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ. This concludes the explanation of these narrations on anger from Hadith 45 and until Hadith 50 from رياض الصالحين. والحمد لله الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات, وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.